Hello friends, welcome to another episode of Engineering Today. Believe it or not, SpaceX has finally done it. The enormous Super Heavy rocket from SpaceX has successfully completed a hot fire test. At around 3:15 p.m. local time in South Texas, SpaceX ignited its Super Heavy rocket for a full duration test of its Raptor engines. Elon Musk, the CEO of SpaceX, said in a tweet after the test that one engine was turned off by the team just before ignition, and another engine stopped by itself. When the countdown concluded, the engines ignited with bright orange flames and massive clouds pouring out as the 23-story tall rocket was held in place vertically on a platform next to a launch tower. Once the booster is connected to the spacecraft, the entire rocket will stand 324 feet high, or 120 meters, making it taller than the Statue of Liberty. Whether SpaceX will conduct another static fire test of the Booster 7 before launching the next-generation unmanned rocket for the first time remains unclear. This means it could operate much like an airliner. The long-term cost savings compared with conventional one-time-use rockets would be immense. SpaceX will now review its data to understand why it couldn't fire all 33 engines on this occasion. It'll also inspect the launch pad to see what, if any, damage occurred during the short firing. Previous smaller-scale engine tests had fractured the concrete under the launch mount, requiring repairs. Mr. Musk had talked about an orbital attempt of the first Starship system in late February or March. Mr. Musk has high hopes for the vehicle. The entrepreneur wants to use it to send satellites and people into Earth orbit and beyond. NASA's already contracted SpaceX to develop a version that can play a role in its Artemis program to once again land astronauts on the moon. Musk himself is focused on Mars. He's long held the ambition to get to the Red Planet, to establish settlements, and, as he put it, to make humans a multi-planet species. He's also talked about point-to-point travel, taking passengers from one side of the planet to the other in rapid time. But the fact remains that the most engines have ever been ignited on a rocket at this particular time. Additionally, the thrust produced by these engines was probably almost twice as much as that of the Space Launch System or NASA's Saturn V rocket. The South Texas launch infrastructure appeared to be largely undamaged, which is good news for SpaceX. The 33 main engines on SpaceX's enormous Super Heavy rocket booster were all fired after years of preparation. This is the first stage of the firm's Starship rocket, which will power NASA's mission to the moon and perhaps one day assist humans in colonizing Mars. The number of engines deployed by this rocket is unprecedented. The Soviet Union's N-1 rocket, which had a first stage propelled by 30 NK-15 liquid-fueled engines, provides the most comparable reference. The Raptor 2 rocket engines attached to the Super Heavy rocket were far more powerful, although each of these engines was only about two-thirds as powerful. The N-1 was a colossal disaster, too. The N-1 rocket made four attempts to launch between 1969 and 1972. It was designed to compete with NASA's Saturn V rocket and serve as the foundation of a Soviet moon program. All of them failed, and one of them, the second launch, which took place in July 1969, just 2 weeks before Apollo 11's moon landing, destroyed the launch site when the rocket malfunctioned shortly after takeoff. Although the company's most recent static fire test in November was successful, it only ignited 14 of the booster's Raptor engines. Prior to transporting astronauts to and from the moon, Starship must make a number of successful test flights. Starship needs to conduct hundreds of flights before it flies people, according to company president Gwynn Shotwell, who spoke at the FAA's annual Commercial Space Transportation Conference. She also emphasized that Starship's initial flight is truly a test flight, and that its true purpose is to not blow up the launch pad. In reality, SpaceX has moved more slowly at Starbase, its development and testing center in South Texas, after a rapid-fire test campaign of Starship prototypes in 2020 and 2021. This is due to the company's likely over $1 billion investment in a huge launch and catch tower to handle Starship and Super Heavy, as well as ground equipment to assist fueling of the enormous vehicles. SpaceX truly doesn't want to take the chance of destroying infrastructure it's spent more than a year creating and testing because so many assets are gathered in a tiny location close to the Gulf of Mexico. As the region would need to be reconstructed, this would push back the Starship launch campaign by at least months. As it stands now, SpaceX is testing the Super Heavy booster by briefly igniting each Raptor engine while the rocket is securely grounded. We'll conclude with an important update today. A senior Ukrainian official stated on Thursday that it's time for SpaceX to decide between Russia and Ukraine after the business announced it was reducing Kyiv's use of Starlink internet devices for operating drones. The Starlink service, which has given Ukraine broadband connections in its defense against Russian soldiers, was never meant to be weaponized, according to Gwynne Shotwell, President and Chief Operating Officer of SpaceX, on Wednesday. Shotwell's admission that SpaceX has restricted how completely Ukrainian soldiers can utilize the technology sports the long-held suspicion that Musk and the business are uncomfortable with Ukraine's military use of Starlink. The choice was criticized on Twitter, another of billionaire Musk's firms, by Mykhailo Podolyak, a political advisor to Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. Thousands of Starlink devices are used by the Ukrainian military to communicate in the field. The corporation offered some of the gadgets at no cost. Podolyak has criticized Musk numerous times since Russia's invasion of Ukraine, despite the significance of Starlink for Kyiv. He wrote, "A year of Ukrainian resistance and companies have to decide. Either they are on the side of Ukraine and the right to freedom and don't seek ways to do harm, or they are on Russia's side and its right to kill and seize territories." Musk's proposals to exchange foreign territories for an illusory peace have been rejected, and he's encouraged Musk not to pessimize Ukrainian government depictions of the conflict. Starlink has been lauded by Ukrainian soldiers as a revolutionary piece of satellite technology that's not only made it possible for them to retain communications, but also improve the accuracy of their artillery and drone attacks on Russian forces. People involved with the discussions said that SpaceX and the Pentagon nevertheless continued to talk about a potential agreement for military units. Shotwell echoed reports and descriptions of the inventiveness of Ukrainian troops on the battlefield when she claimed that SpaceX had never anticipated that Starlink would be used in Ukraine in the manner in which it's been. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.